in the subject of early 18th century steam engines may feel that the continuing argument about the precise location of the first engine, when it's unlikely that any definitive answer will ever be found, and when both rival sites were within about 10 miles of each other anyway, is a bit like debating how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. However, the very absence of definitive evidence means it continues to fascinate and gives researchers the chance to look for new bits of extra evidence. So I think in this paper, Mike Potts has used a little bit of lateral thinking to look for new sources of evidence. And I'll just tell you a bit about Mike. He's a retired instrument and control engineer trained in the nuclear industry with working experience in the nuclear, aero engine and aluminium industries. He became interested in the history of the steam engine some 45 years ago and started to research late 18th century rotative atmospheric engines about 25 years ago. He's a member of the he's the membership secretary of the International Stationary Steam Engine Society, and he's contributed to the talks held by that society in Birmingham during the winter. So, Mike, tell us about your findings on the early history of the Newcomen engine.
Thank you very much. Can everybody hear me? Good. Well, this all dates back to 2012 when the tercentenary celebrations for the erection of the first Newcomen engine in the West Midlands were held. Afterwards, I wondered what the early descriptions of these engines actually said, as opposed to what letter authors had written after studying them. I noticed that some of the books were available as print-on-demand, and print-on-demand covers a vast range of possibilities, some of them better than others. I was lucky, I got decent ones. So I bought the two volumes of Stephen Switzer's book, An Introduction to the General System of Hydrostatics and Hydraulics, in the summer of 2013. My wife Sally went back to work full time in September 2013. So I locked the door, got a cup of tea, and settled down to read these books. Did not expect to find too much of consequence, and certainly did not expect to be standing here this evening talking about these early engines. What I did find set me off into an investigation into the very early history of these machines. Well, at the end of September 2013, I bought two further books, an original copy of Experimental Philosophy, Volume 2 by John Desaguliers, published just after his death in 1744. It's in dire condition, has now been rebound. I can read it without it falling apart. The second book was about the history of engineering drawing, a relatively modern book. It contained two drawings of Newcomen engines, that by Thomas Barney, dated 1719, and this is the Thomas Barney drawing. But there was another one by Sutton Nicholls, dated 1725. And this drawing was complete, including the key to the Sutton Nicholls drawing. I'd never seen this before. And it was a revelation to me just to read it and wonder who had written it. Because Sutton Nicholls certainly didn't. He was an illustrator. He'd been working for years. And the drawing of the engine was just something else that he did. The whole thing then started to take on a new direction and was broadening out far beyond my original thoughts of simply reading an early description of the Newcomen engine. In the end, it became too large to manage as a single talk, so this is part of it. One item, the very early history of what became known as the Dudley Castle engine, and the problems that Thomas Newcomen seems to have met and overcome to get the engine operating successfully. Well, we'll start off with a quick rundown on engines. This is Thomas Savary's pump. He wrote a book in 1699, 1701, the miner's friend, describing this engine and pushing it, even though it didn't really work. The prehistory of the steam engine has been written about many times. The details are very sketchy. Generally accepted that the first use of steam power on more than an experimental scale was by Thomas Savery, born about 1650, died in 1715. His engine worked within limits and was thought novel enough so that it was granted a patent in 1698, which was extended the following year and finally lapsed in 1733. When a truly commercial viable engine was developed by Thomas Newcomen, he had to accept that he had to work under the patent. And in some ways, he didn't do too badly out of it. The patent was for a long time, and he was one license agreement I've read. He was basically the first signatory for the company. This was when Thomas Savery had died, and the company of proprietors had taken over, which they did just after his death in 1715, paid an annuity to his widow and tried to make money. We do not know when he began work on this machine. Stephen Switzer, writing in 1729, claimed he'd been told that Thomas Newcomen was working on it well before 1700 and as early as Thomas Savery. Thomas Savery is generally thought to have started work in the early middle 1690s. Thomas Newcomen was an ironmonger in Dartmouth. In modern terms, he'd be described as a tool manufacturer and dealer. He was undoubtedly supplying miners with tools, but well aware of the problems of draining mines. There's circumstantial evidence that he had one or two workable engines in Cornwall, but there is no explicit documentary evidence until he arrived in the West Midlands in 1711. There's a recent Trevithick Society journal has been published with a paper in it about the possible locations of the two Cornish engines, which is probably worth reading. I've seen a draft copy of it. In this talk, I intend to throw a new light on Newcomen's arrival in the West Midlands and the events leading to the first commercially successful engine erected at Dudley in 1712. We'll start with the premise that Newcomen arrived in the Midlands from Devon with an engine that worked. This engine would have been fitted with internal injection of water to condense the steam and automatic valve gear. However optimistic he might have been, travelling halfway across England with an undeveloped experiment would not have been wise. From his experimental engines, the heavy coal consumption would have been apparent. This is the thing that always gets people, modern writers and thinkers about engines. The efficiency is very low, about less than 0.5%. But it was the only thing that would do the job at the time, apart from horses, windmills, and men. And that was expensive. So coal used in Devon and Cornwall had to be imported from South Wales at great expense. The obvious application in Hungary for coal is draining a coal mine, where fuel in the form of unsaleable small coal, slack, dust is readily available, more importantly, free of taxes levied at the time. This was taxes levied on seaborne coal going from A to B. Thomas Newcomen would have needed a shop window for his new engine, ideally a full-size engine working at a mine where he could demonstrate its possibilities to the mining stewards of the local landowners and to mine lessees. Mining stewards, or coal viewers as they were known in the north of England, were a powerful group of men. Well, a powerful group of individuals, shall we say, because they were very individualistic. They usually enjoyed the close confidence of their employers because they produced a lot of money for them. and were able to throw men, money and resources at any problem that occurred which they needed to solve. They could fall out with the estate who employed them or fail to generate sufficient profits from the mines they managed, could be replaced at a moment's notice. One coal viewer I know in the north of England was sacked twice. After he was sacked the first time, he had to be brought back to because his replacement was so incompetent. And he survived another 10 years or so before his nephew upset everybody, and that did upset the owner, who sacked his nephew and then sacked him without a moment's notice. The next one, the man who took over, John Peel, he served there for over 30 years. So if you were in, you were in. Many worked for many years at the same estate. In the conservative mining industry, they did need to be convinced that any machine would work in the harsh conditions of a coal mine and be financially beneficial, i.e. it would allow them to get to coal more easily, safely, and make more profit out of it. The only real knowledge that we have about the early history of Thomas Newcomen's engine in the Midlands is from John Desaguliers' book, Experimental Philosophy, Volume 2. The notes at the end of the book have been the source of a lot of debate over the years. They give a condensed description of the events after Thomas Newcomen's arrival in the West Midlands, probably in the autumn of 1711. Thomas Newcomen seems to have gone to Griff Colliery in Warwickshire at first, but was turned away by the owner and managers in November 1711. Griff was a very wet colliery. It had been lost in the early 17th century because water could not be got out quickly enough using a dedicated water shaft, a horse whim, and barrels from the Coventry breweries, which were not too far away. The owner and managers at Mining Stewart, Griff, obviously did not just believe Thomas Newcomen's claims that his engine could drain the mine satisfactorily and justify the cost. Though Griff Colliery was at least the third or fourth engine in the world after the engine was shown to work elsewhere. A conclusion drawn over the last 70 years is that Thomas Newcomen then left the Nuneaton area and went straight to the Earl of Dudley. However, the notes say that he contracted to draw water for a Mr. Back of Wolverhampton through an intermediary, Mr. Potter of Bromsgrove. The Earl of Dudley is not mentioned at all. And given John Desaguliers' background and the people that he dealt with on a day-to-day basis, if he'd been involved, I would expect him to have been mentioned. This is possibly the most famous drawing of an early Newcomen engine, though it was not the first one. This is Thomas Barney's drawing from 1719 of the engine at Dudley Castle in Staffordshire. It has a key with it. There are four original copies of this. The first was found by Samuel Timmins in the 1870s. Three more have turned up since then. It was erected at the Conigree Coal Works at Tipton, about 10 miles west of where we're sitting tonight. The engine worked for a considerable length of time. Hello? Is that better? Thank you. I believe, though, that it was originally erected elsewhere. This is Sohail Rana's extractive map on the eastern edge of the Wolverhampton, drawn around 1770. The road running from right to left, which is this one. This is going to Willen Hall. This is Wolverhampton Town Centre. You can see two pits marked adjacent to the toll gate. Toll gate is here. There's one pit marked here. Sorry. And another one here. And the depths are marked as well. The one on the north side of the road is 45 yards deep. One on the south side, 22 yards deep. The map might have been drawn some 60 years after the start of the mining on this estate, but estates do keep good records of significant holes that have been dug on their property, especially if money is involved. William Back might have owned the freehold of the land on the south side of the road, but he may not have owned the mineral rights there. And this, the one on the south side of the road here, is on William Back's land. Fortunately, from a later pit in the section, which is about a quarter of a mile north of the pit on the north, pit shaft on the north side of the road, there was another early 19th century colliery called Old Heath Colliery. This is a section from that pit. It shows the coal and the boundary fault. This is importantly, this is the boundary fault which cuts off the coal. Wolverhampton is over here somewhere. Willen Hall is here. Bilston is over here as well. So the two pit shafts shown on the map here are just on the east of that boundary fault, not very far from it either. South one is about 40 yards, the north one possibly slightly more, but they are certainly very, very close. But what the top seam, so we can get this thing, this one here, which outcrops before the fault, is known as a stinking coal. It was almost unworkable in a thin seam and probably unsaleable due to the hydrogen sulfide it contains. Might also have been fairly dangerous to work because hydrogen sulfide is a toxic gas. It will kill you without in very low concentrations, in spite of the jokes from school chemistry of bad eggs. First worthwhile seam is 45 yards deep, which is this thing here. It's about 6 or 7 feet thick, and it's the one that the pit on the north side of the road accessed. It's a new mine coal. Pit shaft on the north side reached this seam, and the engine there was working in 1736, when it was very adequately described by Richard Wilkes in terms of its dimensions of performance. Richard Wilkes lived at Willen Hall, and he collected information on the area. He did make a comment about the one on the south side, but very fleeting, so it obviously hadn't been used for quite a bit. I believe the 22 yard deep engine pit shaft on the south side of the road was sunk by William Back with the intention to reach this 45-foot yard deep seam. It would have kept him going for a fair number of years. There were probably 10,000 tons of coal in a circle about that pit shaft, 40 yards in diameter, 40 yards in radius, and he could probably have got a half of it out. So it would have kept him, he was an ironmaster, so it would have kept his furnaces going for a day or two, perhaps. When I realised that the shaft ended in barren ground, my first thought was this where William Back ran out of money? And that is, in fact, the question I did ask myself about half a second after I read that, after I realised that he'd missed it. It was ended in barren ground. It was about 'bout here. It just missed the stinking coal outcrop by a few yards, not very many, but it missed it either by accident or design. It was followed very quickly by a number of other questions. If Thomas Newcomen had erected his engine on this site, what did he do, or rather, what could he do to overcome this problem? Because William Back had run out of money and he was to be declared bankrupt before he died. He died in August 1712, so there wasn't a lot of time, given that Thomas Newcomen had been in Griff in November 1711. Thomas Newcomen had negotiated a bargain to raise water with William Back, with the Savarian Newcomen taking a yearly rent and bearing all responsibility for the engine and pump. The engine was never Back's property. Back had borrowed a sum of money, but it ran out, and he never reached the coal seam he was aiming at. Shaft was deep enough to flood. To hit water, flood, provide Thomas Newcomen with the opportunity to show his engine lifting water. Back was made bankrupt, which must have caused Thomas Newcomen great consternation. He would have to shift his property, and quickly, or getting the engine to work would have strengthened his hand and allayed any threat of a breach of contract suit from a man who had just run out of money. A working mine drainage pump could also be demonstrated to potential clients, because he had to find somebody else. He couldn't very well go back to Devon with bits and pieces of an engine that was partially erected. The next piece of evidence probably comes from Henry Baton, a land surveyor and cartographer who lived just south of Nuneaton and just north of Griff, to fill the details in. He must have known John Desaguliers very well, and John Desaguliers' book, Experimental Philosophy, Volume 2, contains his drawings, and he's generally thought to have been the informant who provided the technical details in the book. Part of the notes read as if an exasperated Henry Baton could not believe how little Thomas Newcomen knew about the machine had developed over the period of perhaps 20 years before 1712. The comment is, they were not philosophers enough to understand the reasons or mathematicians enough to calculate the effects, which says something. As I say, I think he was just totally exasperated with Thomas Newcomen. So, this is Henry Baton's first drawing of an engine. Henry Baton was an interesting character. Trained as a land surveyor, he was to draw the first 1 inch to the map, to the mile map of Warwickshire, to publish it in 1725. We do not know exactly when he first knew about Newcomen's engine and became interested in it. Possibly he heard about it in 1711 when the area was talking to Thomas Newcomen about it. We don't know. In 1717, he published the first known drawing of the machine. Well, it wasn't the first known drawing. Well, it was, actually. It is the first known drawing of the machine, of the Newcomen engine. And it has the early valve gear, the He also published in 1717 a table of details linking pump bore, engine cylinder diameter, and depth of shaft from which water was to be pumped, and out of it you got the amount of water you could get out. Result, so you could work things out. He was a surveyor and was to become a fellow of the Royal Society. This work would have been straightforward. This table was published in the Lady's Diary, which he edited for many years. It was a truncated version of the actual table. John de Seguilier published the full table in Experimental Philosophy, Volume 2, near the end of the book. The table had two footnotes, one explaining how to use the table, the second saying that with adequate boiler performance, the engine would run at 20 to 25 strokes a minute. This was very much faster than the normal engine speed of 10 to 12 strokes a minute. After some thought, I came to the conclusion that he'd either seen or been told about an engine running very quickly. Where, when, and under what conditions was unknown to me. It took over a year to find a solution, again with John de Seguilier's notes providing the information once I'd realised what had happened. And I did think about it for a very long time before I got anywhere close to what might be the truth. The crucial sentence in the notes states, "One thing is very remarkable. As they at first were working, they were surprised to see the engine go several strokes and very quick together. And after a search, they found a hole in the piston." That's all it says. But it says three things about the engine. The engine must have been very lightly loaded to run at speed. A back of the envelope calculation shows it must have run at 21 or 22 strokes a minute, pumping from the shallow flooded shaft 22 yards deep. I'm assuming for the moment that he did erect it on this shallow flooded shaft on the Willenhall Road. And we'll take it from there and go through to the end and then see just how good this is. So, 10 to 12 strokes a minute, pumping from a depth of around 50 yards. Must also have been fitted with automatic valve gear. Well, the number of arguments and discussion that's taken place about whether these early engines had automatic valve gear or not is legion. This seems to suggest that it had automatic valve gear to get it to run quickly. And that makes a nonsense of the sentence in the notes stating that internal injection had been invented in the Midlands. The third part of the sentence implies that the piston did not fit the cylinder bore very well. There was certainly no hole in the piston. Might have looked like it, but there wasn't. If the engine had been second-hand from Cornwall, then it would have been better. The fit would have been better. Implication is that the parts were new, or part of it had been remade. We don't know. Newcomen engines will run perfectly happily with injection water turned on all the time. Two people have told me that the Black Country Museum replica engine has done just this. First one saw it happen nearly 20 years ago. The other one saw it happen last summer when they had a difficulty when running it, and it just left the injection water open, and it carried on running perfectly happily. So, with a poorly fitting piston-cylinder combination, a vacuum would form immediately the steam valve was shut. The water would vanish into the cylinder, looking as if there was a hole in the piston, and the lightly loaded engine would run very quickly. The notes also have a sentence about the pumps. Thomas Newcomen must have known quite a lot about mine pumps, coming from a mining area in Devon. However, he could not have brought both engine and pump parts with him because he did not know the depth he would have to pump from. Pump parts were known by foundries. They knew what was meant, but engine parts weren't. There were possibly three engine cylinders in the world at this time. He obtained the pump parts when he knew what was needed. The early engines seem to have used plunger pumps rather than lift pumps. The Switzer drawing shows lift pumps. The top of the Barney drawing also shows a plunger pump. Switzer shows plunger pumps, and so does the top lift of the Barney. I suspect the bottom one is also a plunger pump. So, Thomas Newcomen managed to get his engine working on a shallow flooded pit shaft, albeit briefly. He must have then loaded the engine to run at a speed that could be handled by the boiler. He either hung a second plunger on it, or he put the bottom lift in to work in parallel with the top lift, pumped twice the amount of water, but the engine would be running at the right speed. Piston fit in the cylinder must also have been improved to avoid having a cascade of water pouring into the cylinder all the time. Finally, after a further successful test of the engine and pump, he could claim that he had a working mine pumping system. The next step must have been to let every mining steward and mine lessee in the area know what he had, invite them to come and see it in action. Runs would have been very short, depending on the depth of water in the shaft. The shaft diameter was 6 foot, and looking at the Barney drawing, it does appear to be around about 6 feet in diameter. Then the engine would lower the water level by about a foot every minute and a half. Most important men that he needed to impress were the estate mining stewards, one of whom served the estate of the Earl of Dudley. This man must have seen the engine running and agreed a lease, because the engine was rebuilt at a pit which he controlled. The second engine and the third or fourth engine were also leased by Staffordshire men. The second one was at Horden, that was a colliery run by Staffordshire men. And the third or fourth, we don't know whether Griff was third or fourth, fourth or third. Was at Bilston, the little one at Bilston, which is the subject of the account book in Wolverhampton archives. If matters happened as I have described, then Thomas Newcomen was very fortunate on two counts. He'd managed to lease the engine very quickly after the abortive attempt on the Wilnhall Road site, this time to an enterprise that would not run short of money. His engine had not had to work the Wilnhall Road site, judging by what happened at the mine on the north side of the road. That was also lucky. The engine there was described by Richard Wilkes in 1736. It raised over 2 tons of water a minute, 4 times the quantity that the Dudley Castle engine raised in 1712. A failure to deal with that quantity of water would not have been a good advertisement for the engine and could have set it back considerably. It's a lot of water. 2 tons is a lot for a relatively small mine. So, was the first engine erected on the Wilnhall Road site before it was moved to the Dudley site, where it spent the rest of its working life? The only evidence we have that it was on the Dudley site is the Thomas Barney drawing. However, we're not concerned with the later life of the engine. Starting with the Thomas Barney drawing, what we're looking for is the course of events between November 1711 and when Griff Colliery turned Thomas Newcomen away, and the date in 1712 when the engine was erected and working at Dudley. I believe this date was near the end of 1712, which could have been March 1713 on a modern calendar. For what it is worth, I do think it's very likely the engine was wrecked on the Willenhall Road site and subsequently moved after it had been seen to operate and pump water out of a flooded mine shaft. The evidence is not overwhelming. It amounts to a sentence in John Desaguliers' notes and a shallow and finished shaft on an estate map. We do not really know exactly what, if anything, had happened there, and really we don't. The subject of the site of the first engine in the Midlands is of long-standing interest in the Newcomen Society. The first paper was read by T. E. Lones in 1934. This paper came to the conclusion it had been erected on the Conigree site. The author made the interesting comment that coal was the key. That was basically how I found that this shallow shaft was ended in barren ground. I had the mine section to look at. The second paper was read in 1948 by W.O. Henderson. He claimed it had been erected on the Willenhall Road site, but the meeting came to the conclusion that the evidence was less than overwhelming and more research was needed. Over the years since then, the site at Conigree has been studied, but little more has emerged. 7 years ago, the subject was raised again. Two papers were published by the Newcomen Society in 2009, as your chairman has said. First by Suhail Rana, supported the Willenhall Road site. Second by John Allen and Jim Andrew, said to have been erected on the Conigree site. At the time, I did not know enough about the early history of the Newcomen engine to add anything to the debate. Most of the time up to 3-4 years ago, I've been working on the late 18th century rotative atmospheric engines. And I don't think I can say much more this evening. And many other questions are still outstanding. Exactly how close was Henry Baden to a concept of the power of an engine? John Desaguliers refers to the power of the fire engine in his introduction to Henry Baden's table. What exactly he meant by this is not particularly clear, because the engine power didn't exist at the time. John Smeaton used the term great product to make sense of the data he collected about various engines in the late 1760s up to about 1770. And he collected a lot of information from various people, and he had to somehow do an engineering analysis of it. Engine power was later formalised by James Watt, who defined the horsepower when rotative engines were developed. I think James Watt took what a good horse could do, 22,000 foot-pounds a minute, added 50%, and said that was the horsepower. Well, if he said something that was a 1.5 horsepower was a horsepower, then customers were unlikely to complain very much. Did Henry Baden ever write a description of the Newcomen engine around 1720, as some people surmise? Such a document's never been found. Some people have talked about it, whether it exists or not. We've never found a copy. I was told by a book and map dealer, go and look in Warwickshire Record Office. I've been talking to somebody about Warwickshire Record Office this evening, and possibly not. And until recently, I chose to work on the late 18th century rotative engines. I thought that people had adequately covered the early history, but there are bits still outstanding, it would appear. And I've mentioned John Desaguliers' notes. These notes are about a page of A4 typescript when you transcribe them. I then carried on and wrote about another 8 pages of notes, explanations, and what have you about them, just to try and make sense of what he was talking about. You could write a master's degree dissertation about them, I think, if you tried. So, the estate map on the Willenhall Road mentioned engine pit. This one is from Lancashire, Prescott in Lancashire. You can see engine pit and the depth. But this time, there's a drawing, little drawing of a Newcomen engine by it. And I do have, I think I have one more estate map which shows engine pits. I think that by the mid 18th century, engine pit meant a pit shaft with a Newcomen engine standing over the top of it. But you can discuss this, debate this at length. Over the past 30 years or so, I've collected information about Newcomen and atmospheric engines, some of it detailed, including maps, articles, and books. So this is the engine at Prescott. So I'm indebted to an awful lot of people who've helped me. Most don't know they've done so. They run from those who described the Newcomen engine in the early 18th century to those who are still with us. Chris Hodgrin of ICES organised the two meetings with John Rippon, a coal geologist who once worked for the NCB as a chief geologist, held two meetings. First established where the boundary fault lay in relation to the two engine shafts. The second meeting took place at the headquarters of the British Geological Survey in Keyworth, South Nottinghamshire, where he had a very good contact, and if we'd read everything that was, all the archive material that was supplied to us, we'd still be there. And that was 18 months ago. There were two four-wheel trolleys, 4'6" long, 30 inches wide to get through a door. They were both loaded. And there were four of us looking at them, looking at the information on them. During the first meeting, the Old Heath Colliery section came to light. During the second, the Chillington Colliery was found to be put more or less on top of the engine pit on the south side of the Willenhall Road. The Transactions of the Newcomen Society is an extremely useful source of much that has been written about the engine. I now have access to a more or less complete set. I'm very grateful to the authors of the papers on this engine. John Allen, once the chairman of the Midlands branch of the Newcomen Society, wrote many of these papers in the last 45 years. First one was about the Earl of Dudley's 1712 engine, and he went on at great length about it, including the William Bach episode. Richard Lamb and Steve Grudgens, these are two people I know fairly well now, have allowed information they've collected to be used. Richard Lamb has run a model Newcomen engine for many years. He's one of the very few people to have collected data on the variation of engine speed with the loading. He was given a model Newcomen engine by a local model engineer who built it out of his scrap box, and it looked exactly like that. I've never seen anything quite so rough looking in my life, but it ran. Richard Lamb put a pump on the end, a jackhead pump, which is the type used to pump water by a Newcomen engine to pump water up into the injection water system. It's great. Advantage for a model engine is you can vary the loading by altering the flow, so you can control the pressure and the loading. He's just finishing a new model based on the Dartmouth engine. When it's working reliably, he will extend the work done on the first engine. First met him nearly 20 years ago when I walked into a room at Elsicar at a heritage weekend and found him operating this model engine. For a long time, he gave guided tours around Elsicar at heritage weekends. and I went on quite a few of them. And there were a lot of people went there. Once I went, I couldn't get up onto the beam floor. I think there were over 40 people there. So I shouted down to find out where I was, and I said, I'm down here, I can hear you. And I stood there and listened. Somebody there said that he'd been trying to get in there for 40 years, and this was the first time he'd managed it. Steve Grudgens has given me copies of papers that he's written, been given or found, and I'm very grateful to him. He's working on the South Gloucestershire Mines Research Group, excavating an engine pit at Serridge. In the future, he did say at one point that he was doing something on the Pentridge engine, which went to the Science Museum in about 1718. And as you can see, I haven't found very many slides to show you, because so few drawings of the engine were made in the very early days. Here's some more. So we'll have a look at a few more. This is from John Desaguliers. I think it is Henry Bateman's second drawing, engine drawing, probably done about 1720. It has the slightly later valve gear, which is quadrant wheels to operate the injection cock, as opposed to the F lever that was used on the earlier ones, and which is terrifying to watch in action if you go to see the Newcomen Society of the Black Country. There are a number of other drawings. I found one in the Universal magazine, more or less the same as this, but with two or three people looking at it, but more or less identical. This drawing was published in 1725-26, purports to represent the York Buildings engine erected in central London in 1725. When do you think the last time there was a field at the end of the Strand in central London? Not in 1725, I would hazard a guess. This copy is complete with its key. It's long, and it is very detailed. There are two bits of it. See if I can get this thing working again. This bit here is one chunk. It describes the buoy gear. Starting here and ending here, I think. This describes the valve gear. It is detailed and it says a lot. Whoever, the boiler, B, the alembic or boiler. Does anyone know what an alembic is? Thank you. It's an Arabic word meaning a still or a boiler or a purifier of material, liquid material. It doesn't appear in the latest 20th century Chambers Dictionary, which is the crossword compiler's dictionary. It does appear in the earlier ones, and I do have an earlier one, and I looked to find it. But this is probably as close as we're ever likely to get to a key for Henry Bateman's 1717 drawing. Henry Bateman's 1717 drawing. The drawing is there, it's in the library of Worcester College, Oxford, but no key has ever been found. When it was published in 1924 by the Newcomen Society, some members put a key together to go with it. But I think this is more likely to be what was with it, possibly slightly simpler. For a long time, this was the third earliest known drawing of a Newcomen engine. book was published in Germany in 1728, written in Latin. It's a copy of the Sutton Nicholls drawing with an English translation, while the original, I think he'd got hold of a Sutton Nicholls drawing and simply copied it. This is the well-known one. This is the Stephen Switzer drawing. First drawing and description of a Newcomen engine in English, in an English book, published in 1729. This is where I started when I started all this lot. It's an unusual engine, construction, and some of the details are unusual as well. The frame is all of timber, and it looks very, very slender. That reservoir tank is 50 feet to the top, and it contained about 30 tons of water. I think it would have come down in the first gale. This is a John Smeaton drawing from 1741. Made when he was 18. He later went on to design other engines and to use a method of measuring the engine power in the great product to sort out the effectiveness of engines based on a large quantity of information he collected from a number of sources. Must have been the first engineering analysis of the engine. This is the new Riverhead engine. As you can see, it's still using wooden pipe trees, even though cast iron pipes had been around for years before. This is the drawing of the engine for the City of York Waterworks, 1784. And we started with a Savory pump, we'll end with one. This is a drawing from John Smeaton's reports. The engine was designed by a Mr. de Moura of Portugal, a fellow of the Royal Society, 1752. It's in Smeaton's reports, volume 4, which is the miscellaneous bits and pieces. It's an automatic Savory engine with a float inside to operate it. Quite amazing. Finally, this came through the door last summer for my birthday. Our daughter-in-law has software to make cards, so our son borrowed it to make this card. The uncharitable view would be that I've been talking far too much about these early machines for the past few years. Well, I think my wife, Sally, must be fairly well fed up with them by now, and the last 2 weeks have been even worse, but she has. Well, she managed to put this together. This is the second one I've done. She put it together. We didn't quite get to the divorce court, but we're getting close, I think. For obvious reasons, I'll take the charitable view. I'll certainly keep this card safely. And, as the card implies, good night. Thank you.
Right, as usual, there's an opportunity for questions. There are a couple of roving microphones, and I would appreciate it if you could get hold of one of them before starting to speak. As some of you who are members of the Newcomen Society and where there's an email address known to us, you will have received a message pointing out that last month's lecture was videoed and is now up on YouTube, and we're hoping that the same will be working tonight. But you will be aware that if you watched last month's one, that when in a couple of occasions people didn't get hold of the microphone, there is absolutely nothing on the video of their dulcet tones asking their questions. So if you can, make sure you get the microphone. And I will actually ask, if you know, completely voluntary, but if you're willing to put, say, your name at the beginning when you're asking a question, that might be of of interest to people later. So any questions? I've got the lights in my eyes, so I can't necessarily see you. But right, we've got one down at the front right here.
Thank you, Kevin Hannan. I come from a non-engineering background, but I find this very interesting. Clearly, from what you said, when Newcomen moved from the West Country to the Midlands, he had a large working engine. I'm curious as to how long has it taken to develop that kind of engine, and how long similar types of engines had been used in the West Country. I mean, how far back did the predecessors to this type of engine go in the use in getting water up from mines?
How long is a piece of string? It's generally thought that Thomas Newcomen erected the first engine on a mine around 1703, 1704. And erected another one about 1711. For what it's worth, I believe that he did the development work on the first engine. That was where internal injection was worked out and automatic valve gear. The steam valve automatic gear is fairly straightforward. The injection valve gear is less so. But so that's the nearest I can get. If you, the Trevithick Society, the latest journal, has a paper in it by someone on the sites of the two Cornish engines where they might have been. I would suggest you get hold of a copy of that and read it.
So essentially, Newcomen invented this kind of specific machine from the beginning. I mean,
we literally do not know how he did it, or what he did, or who told him certain information. It is simply in the mists. We don't know.
Okay, thank you.
I mean, as something as simple as the atmospheric pressure. He, according to John Desaguliers, he used an atmospheric pressure, a pressure on the piston of 11.5 pounds per square inch. Henry Baton, in his table, reduced that to 8 pounds. And it was later reduced even more by 1750s. William Emerson, a mathematician, had written a little booklet on it with the formula basically saying, and he was using 7 pounds per square inch. John Kerr, who wrote Engine Builder and Coal Viewer's Practical Companion in 1796, I think, which had a very detailed description of the engine as it was then, he used 7 pounds. One of the last engines ever built, the Westfield engine, was running at about 5 pounds per square inch. So you can see how the pressure has been dropping to get the engine speed up and get a bit more work out of it. And the work that Richard Lamb has done does seem to suggest that at fairly high speeds and low loadings, you do get more work out of the engine. But he only had one point. And one point doesn't make science, as somebody has said recently. I think they were talking about supernova at the time. But a lot of this is still in the mists. We don't know. That's the problem.
Right. Richard?
More or less what I've said. It was on a shaft, it wasn't a coal mine. the Henderson and Sohail Rana have either explicitly or implicitly said that he had a coal mine. It's not true. It was on a flooded barren shaft as far as I can see.
I don't think the microphone's working. Hello? I think we'll just get the other microphone if you just hold on a moment, because.
I'm a current annual pass holder at the Black Country Museum. And I frequently go down into the Newcomen engine replica. And how much is like the original one? It is, is it really life to life?
Which engine are you talking
That's
about?
That's the one actually, Black Country Museum itself on Tipton Road.
Yeah.
So I'm an annual pass holder there, so I'll go down there last week, actually down underneath the engine. Downstairs.
I think the question is just how true to original is the replica at the Black Country Museum.
They took this drawing and made it from that.
Oh,
that's the Barney drawing. And there's another one in New Zealand, half size, that was also made from this drawing. But it uses rather more modern materials, like RSJs, for the framework.
If
you want to see it,
yeah,
put New Zealand Newcomen engine into Google, and you'll get two video clips up there.
Yeah, that's more like the original one than the one in the Black Country Museum. Yeah.
The Black Country Museum replica is from this drawing, the Barney drawing.
So I recognise that when because you go down one down engine, and the other part with a few tips down to the furnace.
Yeah.
And I was down that way, and sometimes they actually run it. I've been there when they've actually run it, and you see the arm moving up and down.
Yeah.
And another thing connected with it, you know, about the Earl and Dudley. Of course, I go under the tunnel there. And, of course, the Earl of Dudley were involved with the limestone with the tunnels. How much was that connected with the... That was a totally different thing, just on the same site.
You would need to talk to the Staffordshire Geology Society or whoever is interested in geology in Staffordshire for that.
All right, that's about that site, yeah. Okay, thank you much.
I think it's thought that there's a bit of artistic license in the way the... floor levels are shown in this, isn't it? I think.
Yes, quite a lot.
Yep.
Is this microphone working?
Yes.
It's very odd. It works if you tap it, but it doesn't work if you talk at it. there's certainly rearrangement. All these early... It's Jim Andrew, by the way, who mentioned earlier. All these early engines... very reasonably, were not actually engineering drawings. They were drawings to help explain how the engines worked. And we've had great fun over the years. Trevelt engine in Sweden, since the engine house survives, it's very possible to see that half the engine has been turned through 90 degrees so that it's all in view in the illustration that's been published. So, yes, there's a certain amount of reproportioning and a certain amount of twiddling of the bits, so that a single drawing could show all the aspects of the engines. So you got some of that. Two other things. I was interested in the that engraving of an engine with a very spindly frame. One of the problems in the idea that the engine was put up near Wolverhampton and very rapidly relocated. These engine houses, and having excavated a rather later 18th century engine house, they are pretty substantial brick things. Had it been put up in a temporary framework, virtually, then that might be an awful lot easier for it to have then been relocated fairly rapidly. to Dudley. Stemming from your mentioning things earlier, Smeaton seems to have been the first person who used a logical system for measuring the performance of the engines. And as part of my thesis, I spent absolutely ages trying to sort out, and I finished up with the conversion factors to alter his three characteristics into load on the engine and horsepower and so on. But it's awfully difficult because he's got it wrong way, and he puts it an unusual way. You know how fuel consumptions on motor vehicles used to be miles per gallon? It's now litres per 100 miles or 100 kilometres or something like that. So it's turned it upside down. And Smeaton did the same, or at least Mr. Watt did the same when he worked through what Smeaton had done. So it is possible to convert them. But all the earlier stuff isn't. And Svante Lindqvist, who did the very extensive write-up on the Trevelt engine in Sweden, came through to me thoroughly confused years ago about the dimensions in the 18th century. And I think when I finished explaining the situation to him, he's probably even more confused. You know, you've got all sorts of things. Swedish miles are three basically English statutory miles. All sorts of things all over the place. So there's an awful lot of that enters into it. And therefore, it becomes very difficult to assess performance. As far as the actual pressures, atmospheric pressure, or the pressure that you use, although it's atmospheric pressure, since most of these Newcomen engines were only condensing down to about 180 Fahrenheit, 90 degrees centigrade, the result of that was that they were only actually taking it down to half an atmosphere anyway. And that's where these figures come from. And of course, it's not just a matter of that's the pressure in the thing. In terms of the working pressure, it's got to be the pressure across it that's actually in a dynamic situation. So when they first started off, and there were a number of the suggestions that when they first started off, they were putting far too high a load on it. And to achieve that load, they'd have to run the engine very slowly, because otherwise you couldn't cool the stuff enough.
Yeah, I would not disagree with you about the loading of the engine at all. The it went down over the years. The people, Henry Burton, picked 8 pounds. I suspect that was a gap between whatever Newcomen was using. And we don't. John Desigulia says what he was using, but we don't know where he got that from. it's in a fog, really. But they did work, and they did pull water out of mines somehow.
Chris, up at the back there.
Hi, Chris Hodrin. I'm the technical advisor to the International Stationary Steam Engine Society and a very close colleague of Mike. We've both been involved closely together in this work and with Suhail Rana. I'd just like to offer a little insight into the interpretation of some of the documentary evidence, because I think it's fairly critical to this Wolverhampton versus Tipton debate. A lot of research was done on the documents by a number of prominent Newcomen Society members back in the mid-60s. There's extensive discussion of the evidence. The evidence is circumstantial on both sides. There's surprisingly little positive documentary evidence for the Tipton site in the first 6 years before the Barney engraving. Actually, you'd be amazed how little there is. I'm not denying there was an engine at Tipton, I'm sure there was. The question is whether it's the same engine as the Wolverhampton one or not. But a lot was made of the fact that the Newcomen engine, the alleged Newcomen engine at Wolverhampton, did not appear in Batch's will. And I'd like to offer an insight on that. Desigulier specifically states that Mr. Newcomen bargained to draw water. He was not selling an engine. He sold a service. He remained owner of the engine. The engines were not sold as a piece of machinery until the time of the Company of Proprietors, which is much later, after Savory's death. So at this time, he's offering a service. He remains the owner of the engine. So of course it's not in Batch's will, because it was never his property. But further to that, a lot's made of the fact the engine's not there, the colliery's not there. There's plenty of mention of the attempt to make a colliery in the bankruptcy proceedings in Chancery, which occurred shortly after his death. So he clearly was trying to develop a coal mine, but the colliery itself is not there in his will. So by that time, whatever had happened to this failed venture had been removed from the pieces of land he was selling. So the absence of the engine in those two documents cannot be taken as any evidence whatsoever that it didn't exist. Of course it wouldn't be there. So I think that opens up, you know, that's the reasoning that's been gone through by quite a few people to say, well, there cannot have been an engine at Wolverhampton. It's just a matter of how you interpret the information. If we then say Newcomen was the owner of this machine and Batch is simply providing a site on which it was to be used, I'd just like you to speculate or to create a mental picture of what this engine means in the technology of 1712. This is the equivalent of the space shuttle, and only Mr. Newcomen has it. The failure of Batch's mining venture, because he ran out of money before they'd reached the coal, as Mike has reasonably described, you'd have been pretty panicky trying to find an alternate site, preferably one as close as possible, because you've got heavy bits to move around, to get this engine demonstrated as soon as possible. So I find it entirely plausible that this engine had a failed attempt at Wolverhampton and was subsequently moved and was successful at Tipton. If you say, why do none of the documentary references mention each other, I cannot begin to imagine. You know, why Daisy Gooley doesn't refer to Tipton is not clear. Why any of the documents refer to Tipton don't refer to the Wolverhampton event is not clear. But clearly a lot of us, including our own team, has agonised a lot over how many months it would take to dismantle an engine at Wolverhampton and move it to Tipton. You know, as Jim has rightly pointed out, you have to build a socking great house at Tipton, and that's not something you do in just a few weeks. I think one insight I had in doing this is that Daisy Gooley is writing long after the event, and many people have criticised other things he wrote. Just maybe he got the date wrong. Supposing the date should have said 1711 for Wolverhampton instead of 1712, everything becomes a lot easier to fit in. Now, there's this famous reference to two of Newcomen's associates being in the nearby Baptist church at Netherton. It does not say they've just arrived. It says they're already here. Similarly, we eventually learn they have gone from us, but we don't have when they left. So they may actually have been up here in the Black Country area in 1711. Yeah, the date of that particular random reference cannot be taken as an arrival date. So that's just a suggestion to drop into the pot.
Thank you very much. Thank you. There's one down at the front on my right. Yeah, and we are, yes.
Evening. Dan Hayton. Just a point that, in fact, if you looked up a French dictionary, you'd find the term alambique, because that's the term the French use for a still.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, it's interesting, although in a slightly different context. There was a question addressed in a paper by Jennifer Tan some time ago, and I forget exactly when, about exactly how many engines were in Cornwall at any given time. And a lot of them reckon were double counted, because in fact, as a mine became unproductive or whatever, for whatever reason, they would simply pick up a Cornish engine, which is a bit bigger than one of these, and move it somewhere, okay, a few miles to a new mine. So the practice of taking the capital investment and reusing it elsewhere, continued for a long time after, even after this.
Yes, I would not disagree with you that engines were moved. The latest Trevithick Society Journal, which has the paper about the two engines, claims two sites now, some distance apart. The and in time as well. But the first one seems to be 1703 to 1705 it was put up, and presumably it then had to be developed.
I think it's again interesting that once the proprietors come in, and again that the yet another new common paper by Alan Smith on the proprietors of the invention of raising water by the impellent for force of for fire, as they said in those days, instead of capital letters, that in fact they were much more clued in than either Savory or Newcomen, really, into the economics of it, because they were essentially the Society of Apothecaries who bought the patent or supported the patent for Savory, who was involved with them. So, I mean, as a London company, although they didn't like to call themselves a company, they were very much had their fingers on the pulse of finance and returns and so on.
I've just got hold of two documents, print-on-demand documents again, both involving John Mears, and they were tied up with the York Buildings Company because apparently he ran that shop as well as everything else. So, and so the two sides of it, the governors of the company and John Mears, and the evidence given, it seems to be largely economic. Remember, this is just after 1720, the South Sea bubble. It was well within living memory. And just carries on going into the mire. And I really do mean the mire. It seems to get worse and worse.
Right, there's one on the left here.
It's interesting you've just raised the South Sea bubble, because it's connected to an interest I have in what you've been saying, which is whether these machines have ever been used. You all always talk about them in the context of mines, but of course they could have been used in other contexts. And a particular context which was very vibrant in the era you're talking about was the competition between the landed gentry to make ever smarter gardens with ever greater water displays. And so pumping water for gardens would have been quite an interesting thing. And in fact, John Desaguliers, who was educated at Bishop Vesey School in Sutton Coldfield before he went to Cambridge, was hired by the Duke of Chandos because of his association with Thomas Savory in order to implement the grand designs of the Duchess of Chandos for the garden they were building in his palace in Edgware. Desaguliers is credited with whatever became of the water systems in the palace in Edgware. In fact, his emoluments came from his position as vicar of St. Lawrence Edgware, which was in the gift of the Duke of Chandos. So my question is, did he succeed? Because the records I've seen suggested that Savory's engine not being viable, that line of approach had been given up. But this was in the period, the palace in Edgware was being built in the period up to about 1720. So the Newcomen engine would have been established by before the garden was properly laid out. So my interest is, did he succeed with using steam power to improve the garden, which didn't survive because the Duke of Chandos, who was the richest man in the land for a period, squandered it all in the South Sea bubble.
Can I just double check this microphone? Is it working?
A bit. Yeah. It's a bit. It's not very.
Thank you. I've just proposed to the secretary and chairman that I do a second one of these, putting the bits in that isn't in this one. This machine, Stephen Switzer's, might just be the answer to, this is later than 1720, but this might just be the answer that you're looking for. And you, so come back and hear what I've got to say on that. I've even got a site for it. But the first one that we know that was used on an estate was the one in Austria, 1723.
Thank you very much. I've got lights in my eyes, so I can't always see him. But,
Do we know how many Newcomen engines were used purely for pumping water, to operate water wheels? I mean, I know of two, but there are presumably quite a few others.
We don't know, really. They certainly were used. I remember going back to Time Team, they were excavating a mill in Manchester somewhere. And it was supposed to be a certain size, and it wasn't. The dimensions were different to the ones they'd been told, so that threw them. And then Mike Neville, the industrial archaeologist who was their advisor up there, he was standing on top of a wall and looking into something. He said, well, that was a well. Then he looked down at his feet and fell silent. And you could see him thinking, well, I'm standing on the beam wall of the engine. They had a one there at that mill in Manchester. Now that's the only one I know.
Well, Abraham Darby reputedly used a steam engine, a Newcomen engine, to pump water back uphill.
Yep.
And I know William Champion in Bristol was. In fact, I think it was a 48-inch cylinder, which yep. at the time was generally regarded to be the largest of a Newcomen yes. engine. He was presumably using it to beat out copper and brass.
Yeah, we don't know. The best estimate is the number of Newcomen engines, and that runs up to 1,800. It's by John Konevsky, and he's getting on for 2,000 engines. Not all of the Newcomen, but there are only 300 and odd Watt engines. So you're talking about over 1,500 Newcomen engines. Now, by that time, there were rotative ones as well.
Yes.
And patent rotative ones. The answer is we don't know. It's really is lost, and it's only slowly coming out. The one at Prescott that I showed, the drawing at Prescott of an engine, of a mine again, that's just been done in the last couple of years. It was published about a couple of years ago. The bits and pieces are coming out, but still a long way to go. We still don't know what's buried in places, in some record offices and what have you.
Well, the William Champion engine, that was actually mentioned in a news item in a London newspaper. That's how I know about it.
It's little things like that that are possibly the only bit of evidence that exists to show that that one of these things might have existed there or here.
By the way, you mentioned Steve Grudgings. I'm from Bristol. I know. Yeah. I've known Steve Grudgings. I'm afraid, thanks to my efforts, a Newcomen engine, which he thought was a Newcomen engine, it's a water engine.
Yeah.
it's referred by R.R. Angerstein in his travel diaries, but he doesn't call it a fire engine, he simply calls it an engine.
Yeah.
And sadly, I found an old map which quite clearly shows it's a water wheel. And bear in mind, it was operated by the River Avon, which is a very fast tidal river.
Yeah.
It would have worked a treat at pumping yeah. out the water.
I have a number of copies of maps from the 18th century. One for Leicestershire shows two fire engines and an engine.
But
building in the middle of nowhere.
I found that map entry by researching something completely different
yeah,
in a
yeah.
different county.
Yeah.
I was actually researching Somerset,
yeah.
but it happened to be in this particular area, the map strayed over into Gloucestershire.
Yeah, it happens. And I've got another engine in North Nottinghamshire from another late 18th century map. It's called an engine, and that is associated with a water mill.
Yeah, well, this one, yep. was it, Cruise Hall, for pumping the water out.
We simply do not know what some of these engines are. Fire engine is a different matter, or an F engine is a different matter. I think we can fairly well assume that they are Newcomen engines, but engine, know, taking your life in your hands if you define it as a nuclear engine or anything else.
Thank you very much. There's one in the front there.
Yeah, and we'll have one over there as well.
Jim Andrews, still trying to get this microphone to work, but also to say that some James Watt engines were used to back pump water wheels.
Exactly.
Because until they got the rotative engines going, that was the way you got rotative motion out of a James Watt engine.
If we're in the business of not asking questions, but giving information, that can carry on from the question that I think you were asking about the number of Newcomen engines that were used to pour over a water wheel. Well, the first one I know about is the one at Griffin, 1770-odd, and that had a whopping great big Smeaton water wheel, something like 38 feet diameter, and the Newcomen engines there, I think there were two of them, they pumped water from below up into a reservoir and then sprinkled it back over this Smeaton water wheel. And to save having two sets of buckets, they had a reverse gear with some great big gears on to change the direction of the pumping and winding of the coal out of the mine. But to carry on from what you were saying about the Simpson engine, which was put in God knows when, but it was falling to pieces in 1790, and they were desperate to put a Boulton and Watt engine in place of it. But since Boulton and Watt took ages to produce their engines, they were desperate. And what they were doing there was they had a Newcomen engine in 1790 in what was originally Arkwright's cotton mill, and that was used to pump water over the water wheel, and it was the water wheel that drove the cotton mill. So there was a good long history of using such engines to run a water wheel. But the interesting thing to follow from that is that in 1790, the cotton mills around there still had quite a lot of Savory engines working, didn't even use Newcomen engines to try at any rate to make the cotton mills work. And they claimed they were very efficient, but I think they were rather lying, I suspect. And finally, going back to this business of horsepower, it has always seemed to me, and perhaps it does to a few others, that the number 33,000 was not a coincidence, and it wasn't to do with horses being added to 1.5 horses. It was only because it was a damn convenient number to use, because it's 100 over 3. And when you look at all their calculations, they are always fiddling about with 100 over 3. Very, very convenient with 60 minutes and 60 seconds as well, and all the 60s and 3s and 100s disappear very rapidly. just for interest. Yeah.
Thank you. There's one over on that side.
Thank you. Just going back to your point about the Cornish engines and in fact the engines at Tipton, how long, we talk about moving them, but how long did it actually take to move an engine?
Well, it depended how many people you could throw at it. I think the mining steward at the Earl of Dudley threw people at this job. He didn't, it was, when he was doing it, it was late summer, autumn. The ground was hard, he could move stuff easily, and he had plenty of men to do the job. And he wanted this engine. I think that's what happened.
Mm.
And he just threw people at it. Steve Grudgens in one of his books, about a 1751 engine, he showed that they were moving these things in the middle of winter.
Right.
When the roads were, you tell me what the roads were like, probably quite miry at the time.
Yeah. So we don't really know, we talk weeks, days, weeks, months?
Well, think about it, if we look at the timeline if it was on the Willenhall site, it probably started sinking the shaft in say March, when things were clear, were getting a bit clear. That's the end of March, that's the middle of March 1711, which is March 1712. They could shift about a yard of dirt a day digging a shaft for an ordinary mine. The Newcomen engine was a bit bigger, I think. Engine shaft was a bit bigger, possibly 6 feet in diameter. The Barney engine seems to be 6 feet in diameter, which is about 50% more spoil to get out. So 2 feet a day, 22 yards, you're talking about 6 weeks.
Mm.
So it's end of April, middle of May. You've got to the shaft and William Buck has run out of money. Thomas Newcomen then, it then floods, the shaft floods, and Thomas Newcomen has to decide what to do. And we don't know what the license agreement said for that particular engine. I think that by the middle end of June, he had a working engine on that shallow pit.
So in this particular case, you're talking about 3 months?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That engine house was still there when they were disposing of William Buck's assets. So he must have built the engine house. And that's possibly where he ran out of money. He had to dig a bigger shaft and he had to put the engine house up. And he could well have run out of money doing just that.
I mean, the shaft is obviously the thing that's going to take the longest time to build. Yeah.
And if he'd got it running by the end of July, which is just about when William Buck died, he died at the beginning of August, they could have had another engine house. If the shaft was already there, they could have had another engine house built fairly quickly, I think, certainly before Christmas. Remember, these are the first two engine houses that have been built on sedimentary rocks. We don't know what happened. The engine house could start sliding towards the hole in the ground that was 5 feet from its wall.
Yeah.
We simply don't know. Because according to John Desigulia, they had a lot of problems with the engine.
Okay, thank you.
I think somebody is waving up behind you up there.
Chris Hodrian again. If I could just comment on this issue of how long does it take to build an engine house. I've studied in detail the case of the Chester flour mill engine built by Bolton in Watt in 1785. It's a relatively early engine. It's so early it didn't have a governor. Bolton and Watt, with all the massive resources of their organisation, the factory producing all the parts, many of them in-house apart from the boiler and so forth, they took an entire year to erect a complete project, not involving digging a mine shaft. That's why all of us are really, really struggling with this concept of, did this same engine get moved from Wolverhampton to Tipton? I would suggest that Newcomen, with his very primitive resources, working a long way from his home base in Dartmouth, would have been really struggling to do things fast. Having said that, it's only 10 miles down the road. He's not having to move the parts a great distance. So I think a lot comes down to, actually, not so much how fast you dig the shaft, maybe how fast you can build the engine house and leave the cement or lime, mortar, whatever you're using, to cure long enough that the brickwork becomes really strong. And I'm not clear how long that is. Does anybody in the room have any expertise on that? Jim, for example?
I think the actual engine itself was a bit of a kit of parts, really, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I suppose the cylinder was quite big.
For what it's worth, I think Newcomen only brought one set of engine parts with him. He couldn't afford any more. Remember, we're talking about a brass cylinder and a brass cylinder bottom, plus ironwork, plus a boiler, which is almost certainly copper.
According to that,
but as just been said, it's the engine house that you've got to get in I really don't know. I'm not a builder, as quite a few people will tell you.
Any others?
From more modern experience, a lot of things depend on how much the user wants the product. And as you say, you've got the opportunity to throw men at the problem because you need the engine to get the mine working. What are you going to do with... Well, you're not paying the miners, but you've got the miners there that you could pay to help build, move, do the donkey work.
I would not disagree with you. It had possibly got to the point of a vanity-type project for the Earl of Dudley.
Jim?
If this one's working, final point. Savory's engines did not die. Around 1870, they reappeared. They were called pulsometer pumps. They were used as contractors' pumps because they were very simple and they were only lifting water out of holes in the ground on contractors' sites. And they continue to be used to be available for a whole century. They only stopped after World War II. So Mr. Savory actually sort of had the last laugh because as steam pressure became a lot more available with higher pressure steams, his idea worked. It worked very simply. The simplest of the lot, the pulsometer pumps, they had rubber flap valves. There was virtually nothing to wear out. And they would run and run until they disintegrated.
Yes, the small Savory engines used for houses seem to have worked beautifully. The first one, according to Switzer, was put up at a potter's house in Lambeth, and they managed to blow the tiles off the roof. Presumably, they had the pipe going up, but they didn't have it curved over. So as you got the column of water getting less and less, it was accelerating quite rapidly. And the last, that much water must have gone out like a bullet. No wonder the tiles got wrecked.
In the front there.
Very quick comment on the pulsometer. About 1998, I was up in an Austrian mountain on one of the narrow gauge railways. And at the end of the run, had run back down to the actual lake level, the locomotive took a pipe from the loco, plugged it into the bottom of a pulsometer pump, and pumped it straight back into the boiler from the lake, and then carried on its way.
Using steam from its own boiler?
Using steam from the boiler, but using a pulsometer pump.
Right, that probably is... Is it time to draw things to a close?
Not quite 3 centuries.
Yeah. So, wait a minute, there is...
Somebody had his hand up.
Anybody still want to... Yep. We're up for time at the moment.
To end on a humorous point, there was a Boulton-Watt rotary motion engine. It's all been set up and everything. But it still wasn't working because the two men responsible for it were rather over fond of strong drink. and they'd sent one of their men down, and that's what he reported back.
Well, if you look at the Dudley Castle drawing, you'll see a little bench with a bottle of beer beside it.
I suspect quite a lot of the technology came from the brewing industry and the distilling industry in those days anyway, didn't it? Right, on that note, we better draw tonight's proceedings to a close. I think it's very interesting hearing about the extra sources of information that you found in slightly unusual places, interesting that... with the reference notes. I think that's a useful find. And a lot of interesting stuff has come out tonight. So I think we've all had a most interesting and entertaining time. So let's say thank you to the speaker. I will now ask Jim Ranahan just to tell us about next month's meeting and a few other minor things, and I've got one announcement to make at the end.
Thank you. Thank you, Mike, for a great talk. Just to remind everybody that you can go to the Black Country Living Museum to see the replica Newcomen engine, and you can go downstairs to see James Watt's later engine. I'll leave you to work out where else you can go in the country as well. Can I say thank you to Chris, the technician, who's looked after us tonight and looks after us for most of our meetings. The discussions tonight can be carried on in the Woodman pub across the road. The talk next month is by Jim Andrew, and he will be talking about the Napier Lion Aero engine, which was also used in record-breaking cars and in speedboats. Again, you'll probably all know that Think Tank holds the Railton record-breaking car that's powered by the Napier engines. So that's next month, the 6th of April. I'd just like to remind people about the partnership that Newcomen Midlands has with Think Tank. We're very grateful for the resources that they make available to us, not least Chris, the technician. I'd ask you, if you haven't already done so, to sign in on the form at the front, whether you're a member or a visitor. You're all equally welcome. The recording of the details helps us to show Think Tank how successful we are at attracting people to the premises with our programme, with our lecture programme. There's a donation box on the table, and we just ask if you feel that you want to contribute anything, that will go to helping us just with little running costs for the Midlands branch, so that we're not too much of a burden on Think Tank for the administration. There is also a leaflet on that table which has contact details for Midlands branch. It has the society website, it has the Midland branch email, and it has our Twitter account for the Midlands branch. I mention Twitter because Midlands are one of the two regions at the moment piloting the use of Twitter for the society. Scotland is also doing that, and Northwest branch will come on with that shortly. If you're not already using it and you want to dip into it, you'll find a lot of information about society activities, and you'll also find relevant industrial heritage engineering information as well. We're not exactly in competition with Scotland, but the more followers we can encourage down here, the better. the other thing with Twitter, just at the moment, is that we've already attracted a very interesting post which relates to the 1973 Midland branch visit to Workington Steelworks. That post has provided a very good range of photographs taken on the visit. So we'll work out how we can make that set of photographs available to members. But I also ask, if anybody remembers going on the visit, I'd welcome your thoughts and reminiscences about that, and also any other reminiscences about that very pioneering period for the society in the Midlands. I think that's probably it.
Usual things. Yes. Now I was just going to mention before we go that tomorrow evening here in Think Tank, there's a lecture being given by Sir James Walport, who's the government chief scientific advisor, and he's talking about how will we power the UK in the future, because you know everybody's worried about the lights going out if we don't, if we close all the coal power stations and don't put something else in its place. It's at 6 p.m. tomorrow evening, 5 doors open 5:30. You can just turn up, but if it's like, if you're worried about it, if you want to be certain of a place, then if you ring the main think tank number, which I've got on this sheet of paper, if anybody needs it, and ask to be put through to, well, choose option two off the voice choice, then you can just get, you'll be given a reference number to confirm your admission. So that might be of interest to some people, I think. As I mentioned briefly when we were starting questions, we are now trying to video record these lectures. The first one, as I say, appeared covering the last month's lecture on the steam submarines. If you want to find that, and in a couple of weeks' time see if this one's safely appeared, then if you do a search on YouTube for Newcomen Society, you should find those, plus some one or two others from other venues. That means anybody who can't get here can still pick up most of the best of our meetings. So anyway, I look forward to seeing you all in a month's time for the last meeting of this current season, and meanwhile, have a good month.